Now, the IMF has sounded a note of caution. 10 years after Lehman Brothers, it says the global economy is susceptible to another meltdown. It cites financial vulnerabilities, of course, pretty much contributed by ultra-low interest rates that's resulted in debt. Some countries' debt is bursting at the seams. This is all happening as rates are rising, central banks are normalizing, and also happening at a time when there's uncertainty what the trade tensions between the US and China may bring and how prolonged that may be. So what are the implications? What can we expect? Let's put the world in perspective with Jose. Good to have you with us. In terms of financial vulnerabilities, the IMF says that in the short term, the risks are pretty moderate. What's your take on it?
I think so. I think that we cannot forget that we still have growth rates which are among the highest in the last few years, certainly since 2011. And even if it's the case that there is now some moderation of growth rates going forward, but we're still in a pretty good situation now. That doesn't mean being complacent, and we need to be aware of the risks. And I agree that the risks, the downside risks to growth have become more dominant over the last few months. And that has been in part due to the concerns raised by the trade conflicts between the United States and China and the possibility that those trade conflicts may move beyond these two countries and then have a deeper impact on the global economy. So that has taken some toll in terms of trade, in terms of investment, and that's something which is behind the moderation of growth rates going forward. But still, let's not forget that we will continue having, on the basis of the central scenario, healthy growth rates for the next couple of years at least.
Healthy growth rates, but the risks are rising. Yet when you take a look at the market, there seems to be a lot of complacency, overconfidence. You take a look at the markets in the US, for instance, it's been, well, minus today and overnight, it's been testing new highs and valuations are pretty stretched. Are markets now only beginning to see the reality of rising rates?
Well, I think that some markets are quite richly valued. Equity markets in the United States is a quintessential example, but also in fixed income markets, they are corporate debt markets where the spreads are very low and perhaps not compensating enough for the risk that the lenders are taking. So from that point of view, the correction that we had in US markets last night, I think that should be de-dramatized. This is something which, you still have very high valuations, and it's not unnatural for stock markets to react in that way when you have someone like the IMF saying, listen, going forward, growth is going to be a little bit slower than you expected, and when you also have some increase in long-term interest rates in the United States. So I think that this is something that should be de-dramatized, and I think that that correction is not out of the ordinary.
And Trump himself said that this is a correction that's a long time coming, but others also say this is just the beginning of a correction. Where do you sit on that?
Well, it's hard to say. Markets go up and down, but I think something we should not forget is that the global economy still remains strong, that the United States economy is projected to continue growing at a healthy rate this year, next year a little bit less, and yes, eventually there will be some reduction of the the beneficial economic impact of the fiscal impulse, but from that to saying that, over the next 2 or 3 years, we're going to go into a recession in the United States or anything like that, I think is much more far-fetched. Growth will be moderated at some point. In the United States, there may be a recession, but that's something which is not seen in the forecasts that have been issued couple of days ago by the IMF for the next few years. So the fundamentals still are good, although the risks need to be monitored and no one can be complacent, and particularly emerging markets, which have to keep their guard high in order to protect themselves against any headwinds that may be originated in the global economy.
Of course, we've seen the U.S. normalizing faster than the rest of the world. What are the implications of this divergence? Because we've already seen the spillover in emerging markets, and we've heard from the likes of Ibushi Mulani Inawati saying that, you know what, the Fed has to be mindful about raising rates and the implications on EMs.
Yeah. I think that the Fed is doing what's right, which is raising interest rates as the United States economy.
At such a pace?
Well, I think that if you look at the economy in the United States, unemployment rates are at full employment or even below what is considered to be the natural rate of unemployment. Inflation has been picking up, and now core PCE, which is the measure that the Fed looks at, is at 2%. So I think that the fact that the Fed started raising interest rates before is what any good central bank should do, because you have to be ahead of the curve rather than behind the curve. So I don't think that there is anything to be criticized in terms of the pace of the Fed. And so far, both the full employment and the price stability mandate of the Fed are being fulfilled. Now, the extent to which the Fed needs to take into account the repercussions of its policies in the rest of the world, well, the Fed already does take that into account in the sense that they look at the spillovers of their policies on the rest of the world and the spillbacks into the United States. And that's something which has been going on for a long time. And I remember at the time of Ben Bernanke, this conversation, which is happening these days, already taking place, and the Fed arguing that this is what they were doing, and this has continued in Janet Yellen's time, and it continues now. And I think that the Fed needs to be faithful to its mandate, which is something which is constitutionally given to them, but of course they do take into account the impact to the rest of the world and back to the United States.
But can there be better policy coordination?
I think there's an area where I would like to see somewhat different policy attitudes, which is in the area of trade. And that's an area where, unfortunately, we're seeing trade conflicts that I hope can still be avoided and not let us go into any sort of trade wars. And we know that trade wars, like all the type of wars, only have losers, no winners. And that's an area, I think, where the spirit of multilateralism, the spirit of global coordination and cooperation needs to be very present in order not to undermine the multilateral trade system that was put in place after World War II and that has served the world so well in the last four decades. And I would just like to add one thing. If you look at what happened in the world in this Great Recession and compare it to what happens during the Great Depression, I think there were three things that were different that explain why this was a recession, painful as it was, but not a depression, which could have been cataclysmic. First, because you had economic policies reacting in a much more powerful counter-cyclical way. That was critical. Second, because you have built-in automatic stabilizers in the economy, like the unemployment insurance system, that helped demand to be more stable. And third, because the multilateral trade system did not implode. And that happened after the Great, in the Great Depression, because the United States imposed tariffs and then many other countries followed. And therefore there was an implosion of global trade and an implosion of global growth. This time, that didn't happen. And global trade, although it was reduced during the Great Depression, did not implode. And that is a key differentiating factor. So I think it would be very important that in this area of trade, there is as much cooperation as possible and not as much conflict as we are seeing in the past few weeks and months.
But what are the risks? In my conversation with the WTO Director General just yesterday, he said there are no constructive conversations between the US and China right now. What are the implications of that, and what's your take on the risks of a longer term, a prolonged trade war between the two?
Well, until it's really demonstrated that things go the wrong way, I'm hopeful that something can be worked out.
What's the worst case scenario?
Okay, the worst case scenario, of course, I mean, the IMF has looked at this in the things they have published the last few days, and we at Standard Chartered have also done research on this. And the fund, for example, would say that if the present threats regarding trade are fully implemented and therefore materialized, that this is something that could cost the global economy something like nearly 1% of growth in the short term, and over the medium term, 0.5% of growth. And I think that this is something that the world cannot afford. And the impact would be most immediately felt in the case of China and in the case of the United States. If you were to think, for example, that trade between China and the United States were to cease, and now I shift to the Standard Chartered estimates, that would mean that China would lose 3% of GDP and the United States would lose 1% of GDP. And those are non-trivial numbers. And the impact that this would have on confidence in other countries would also be very relevant. Think of the global supply chains or the Asian supply chains, the integration they have with Asia. I think that this is something which is not good for anyone. So, of course, in this type of situations, one needs to exercise quite calm judgment and make sure that the short-term political pressures don't take you to a situation where everybody loses, because given the interlinkages in the global economy, you know, a lot of what the United States is importing from China incorporates components that the United States is exporting to China in other ways. So these interactions need to be taken very much into account.
You talked about the global supply chain. Should there be a breakdown, do you see perhaps Southeast Asian countries benefiting from that, from the tweaks in the global supply chain as a result of the U.S.-China trade war?
I mean, I think there are direct and indirect effects. Since China and other countries in Asia have such integrated global supply, you know, supply chains, if there are less exports from China to the United States, in principle, that's going to have an impact on the economies which are contributing to those exports by the goods that they sort of, or the inputs that they provide to China. So that's one direct effect. Second indirect effect may be that China diverts trade to other countries. And for example, at Standard Chartered, we finance very little of the trade between the United States and China, but we finance a lot of the trade between China and other countries in our footprint, in Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. So from that point of view, there could be a beneficial effect on some of these other countries. But again, that's something which will happen insofar as China diverts trade. There would also be, over the medium term, even relocation of productions. Mm. Things which are manufactured in China would be manufactured in other countries to be exported to the United States. But those are longer term trends which will require some delocalization decisions. So things would be upset by those things, but let's not forget, regardless of whether some countries may end up with some, you know, benefits from this trade diversion, that for the global economy, this trade, if this comes to be a trade war, this is something that would be very damaging given the numbers that I was mentioning beforehand.
Jose, I want to touch on China. Of course, Steven Mnuchin has taken issue with China's, I guess, the weakness of the yuan, and he calls it possibly competitive devaluation of the currency. Do you see that as a competitive devaluation? Is China doing that on purpose?
I don't think so. I don't think that if you look at the path that the yuan has followed in the last few years, you can say that there's been a deliberate strategy for the currency to depreciate. And in fact, the Chinese authorities have been taking measures to avoid a bigger depreciation of the currency over time. So I do not think that is something which is clear to me. And if that strategy had been there, it would have been very apparent in a number of metrics, like foreign exchange reserves or all the things, and we certainly have not seen that. I think that China has other issues, which is how to navigate, on the one hand, the rebalancing of the domestic economy, particularly to make sure that there is some deleveraging in an economy which has been increasing very much its debt levels, particularly at the corporate, and but also the household, but mainly the corporate debt levels, and that deleveraging is something which is a policy objective of the authorities, but they have to balance that with making sure that economy's growth doesn't come down. And so far, the monetary and fiscal policy actions that the Chinese economy, the Chinese authorities have taken, seems to indicate that they can keep growing at rates between, above 6%, between 6.2 and 6.6% this year and next, and therefore that's something which for them is quite important. So that's where I see the Chinese authorities, but not manipulating the exchange rate. They have learned better that they can do monetary and fiscal policy support in order to provide the kind of growth momentum that the economy needs.
But possible to see a further weakening of the yuan, some say past 7, 7.5. Do you see that happening?
I don't know. I don't have a crystal ball. I would tell you.
If you were to hazard a guess?
I would tell you one thing, though. It may make sense. It makes sense in many countries to have the exchange rate, which is quite a flexible sort of variable, to absorb some of the shocks which affect the economy. And that is something which is the case in all advanced economies. They have floating exchange rates. In China, that's not the case. There is not a floating exchange rates, but the authorities have committed already a couple of years back to have more exchange rate flexibility. So I think that if there are headwinds in the Chinese economy, the exchange rate is in any country a natural tool of adjustment, and it is legitimate to use it in China as in other places. But that is very different from deliberately manipulating the exchange rate. No one would say that the euro, when the euro weakens, or when the dollar weakened in the past, this was something which was a deliberately engineered policy. This is something that happens because countries are in different situations, because growth rates differ, because monetary policies differ, and therefore capital flows tend to go to different places, and that makes the adjustment of exchange rates being one direction or another.
But the weakness of the yuan has implications on emerging market currencies.
Indeed.
They're pretty much linked. What risks are there for EM currencies if the yuan continues to weaken?
Well, of course, it would create issues in China in particular from the point of view of competitiveness. But I think that if you look not at what could happen in the future, but what is happening, what you see is that the dollar strength vis-a-vis other currencies, this is something which is creating pressure on emerging markets. And the fact that, as we were discussing at the beginning, that the Fed had naturally increased interest rates and that the dollar has strengthened as a result. This increase in interest rates has also led some emerging markets, especially those with pegged exchange rates, but also many others, to have to increase interest rates to avoid significant capital outflows, and that has tightened financial conditions in emerging markets. So what you have now in the world is a different situation where, yes, interest rates are tightening in the United States, but if you look at broader index of monetary conditions or financial conditions, they're still relatively easy compared to what they could be, while in emerging markets, the tightening has been much more evident. So that I think, that asymmetry, I think is interesting. And going forward, as the European Central Bank, for example, comes to raise interest rates, as they indicated, as of the third quarter of next year, then that is going to add to the pressure around the world. So that's a reality that emerging markets need to live with, and the best defense against that is to make sure that you maintain attractive interest rate differentials so you don't have too big capital outflows, but also that you keep your financial systems very stable and very resilient to withstand whatever headwinds may happen, because we know that the financial system is the core of the economy, and when things go wrong in the financial system, then you have a very critical situation. So countries, for example, like Indonesia, which have a resilient financial system, which have sound monetary policies, which have sort of sound fiscal policies, which are now embarking on a path of structural reforms, infrastructure developing, and so on, I think that this would be a country which is doing a lot of the good things that would be recommended to any country, And that is something which will provide it with the strength of fundamentals, which are good to navigate these uncertain times.
Yet the Indonesian rupiah has been smacked. I mean, like you said, the central bank and the finance ministry have taken textbook solutions to ensure stability in the currency, but that hasn't happened yet. It tested 15,000 and it could go even lower. In your view, what can be then, what can be done and what other steps need to be taken to return stability to the currency?
Well, think of the counterfactual of what would have been the case with the currency in Indonesia and with the economy in general if the policy of the government had been not as prudent from the monetary, the fiscal point of view, and so on. I think we would be now in a very different situation. What this is telling you is that the country needs to persevere, in my view, in this direction, and they need to reinforce the confidence of international investors in a country which still has, you know, tremendous potential, and there was a discussion previously on that. It's a country with tremendous potential, with the potential for a fantastic demographic dividend, but of course you need to educate the population and make sure that you provide jobs for them, and that you provide the structural reforms and the infrastructures that allow the economy to grow at an even higher rate than the 5% or 5.3% where the country is
growing. So you've been satisfied with the policy responses?
I think that if you look at the international commentary on Indonesia and the assessment that we and others make of the Indonesian policies, I think that these policies have been going in the right direction, and of course, you could always do more. But I think that if these policies...
When you say they can always do more, what more
well,
can they do?
I think that investors also look at the medium term and whether these policies are putting the country on the right path for growth. And there are things which are important in Indonesia. Infrastructures is one of them, and the country is working on that. As I was saying one moment ago, education is another fundamental thing. Over the medium term, the development of industries like tourism, which are a source of diversification and strength for the economy. And we're sitting in Bali, which is a touristic place. But the contribution of tourism to the Indonesian GDP is very small compared to other countries in Southeast Asia. So these are all things which help diversify the economy. And then continuing to put in place the business-friendly environment which attracts foreign direct investment, which is very critical for Indonesia.
You talked about the need to build infrastructure in the country. I guess in wanting to bring back stability to the rupiah, the government has decided to hold back on billions of infrastructure development spending. Was that the right move? That could impact growth in the future.
Well, you need to go in the direction of structural reforms. And infrastructure spending is something which adds potential to the economy. So that's what this reform is about. But of course, you need to make sure that you make consistent the pace of infrastructure investment, which is, you know, very significant over the next few years, with the fiscal capacities of the government. And we were talking about before that this is a country which has a small current account deficit in a small fiscal deficit. So it has a twin deficit. And that's something which speaks for revenue mobilization, so that you have more capacity through revenues to finance infrastructure, and pacing well the spending over time so that this spending is consistent with the fiscal deficit being kept under control. Because if you either have fiscal public finances go wild, or if the central bank were to fall behind the curve in terms of the tightening of monetary policy, then is when you may have a critical problem in the rupiah. And so far, the authorities have been successful in managing or navigating these monetary and fiscal policy paths together with the infrastructure development spending in a way which is consistent with what we would call good fundamentals. In spite, there has been some depreciation. It's not been massive, it's been significant, but not massive. But again, remember, the exchange rate is a variable that can adjust to allow for some of the external tensions to be better absorbed. And there's been some absorption through the exchange rate as well.
Jose, for Standard Chartered, when you take a look at Asia, where do you see the biggest opportunities for the bank?
Well, Asia is, for us, very important. Asia is about 65 to 70%, at least 70% of our revenues. And it's critical for us, and it's been critical throughout our history. And you have areas like China and Hong Kong, and I think that you have to think from the economic point of view of China and Hong Kong as a sort of super connect, as something which is closely integrated. That's a fantastic opportunity, I think, not just for the bank, but also for the world. That part of the world is providing the key contribution to global growth, but so is Asia, right? Asia is contributing to around 60% of global growth in the last few years. And from that point of view, if you go down, you know, countries like India are growing very rapidly. It is a very large economy, Southeast Asia also. So all of this part of the world holds tremendous opportunities. One Belt, One Road, that initiative is something that links China to many countries in Asia, in the Middle East, and in Africa, where we have most of our footprint. And we are the country which is present in more countries of the Belt and Road than any other bank. We understand very well the local risks. We understand how to make projects bankable by identifying the risk and mitigating these risks. We understand very well what Chinese companies may want, because we have been in China for 160 years, as we have been in many of these markets, and we're plugged into the largest financial centers in the world, like London, like Singapore, and Hong Kong. And then we're able to bring in the capital which is needed in addition to the advisory capacities that are needed to make that a reality. So that would be an example of something which would be particularly important from this part of the world.
Some say that the Belt and Road Initiative is a debt trap. What's your response to that?
I think the Belt and Road Initiative, if you think of it as something which is enhancing the interconnectedness among economies to promote trade and growth, I think that this is something which is a positive. Now, it is very important, nevertheless, that several things happen. First, that the projects which are undertaken under the Belt and Road label are projects which are well designed, which are viable also from the commercial point of view. That's what makes very important the participation of the private sector, because the private sector will ensure this commercial viability, that these projects are subject to transparency standard and good governance standards, and again, having the involvement of the private sector is very useful to make that happen. And if those conditions are satisfied, that projects are well designed so that they'll congeal the revenues that help pay back the debt that was incurred to finance these projects, if they are well governed and transparent so that there are no opportunities for corruption or any other funny things, I think that these projects will be important in fostering trade, investment, and that will contribute to growth and development. And I think that's the way to look at it, and I think that the private sector can contribute a lot to the success of the Belt and Road Initiative by making sure that these projects are the right ones, and then that they are sort of managed in the proper way.
We only have about a minute or so left, so I just want to wrap up. The final question is, you know, there's so much uncertainty in the world today. If there's one worry that you have that could derail growth, that could derail Asia's projection, for instance, what would that be?
I think it would still be trade wars, big scale. So let's hope that doesn't happen.
All right, on that very sobering note, thank you so much for your time today. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.